Our next speaker, I'm going to hand the podium over to Dr. Paul Ribsky, Associate Professor of Physics, to introduce Mark Geller. Paul.
Good morning. I'm the car person on campus. I'm the one responsible for organizing the car showing, which will occur right after this lecture, or starting at about 11 o'clock, and run until 2:15. So it's long enough that those of you who are in sessions right after this lecture probably will have the opportunity to come over. I want to mention that we've got some very interesting cars on display. One showed up that I was unprepared for. This was a Geo Metro conversion to electric. It's a fully electric vehicle. It is the only highway-capable electric vehicle that we have on display. But it was a homemade conversion. It uses a surplus forklift motor and surplus batteries, probably done for less than $2,000. And it's got a 5-speed forward transmission, at least 4, possibly 5. 5-speed, thank you. There's the person who did the conversion right here in the audience. I'm really pleased that we have that automobile here because we've never had that before. At the same time, I'd like to recognize Smart Motors, who is here. Smart, could you stand up, please? Where is Smart Motors? There they are right there. Smart Motors is a Madison Toyota dealer who have been here now for 3 years. This is their third year participating. And they have both a Camry hybrid as well as a Toyota Prius on display. Unfortunately, they could not bring the new Gen 3 Prius down because that's not going to be released until June. We also have a Honda dealer, Zimbrick Honda. Is Zimbrick here in the audience? I don't think that they'd arrived yet. They are going to be bringing down the new Honda Insight, which is going to compete directly with the Prius, they say. It will not have as good a gas mileage, they say, but tests show that it's getting Prius-like mileage. So I think that the new Honda Insight, is going to give the Prius a bit of a run for the money. Having said that, we also have automobiles that are fully electric. We have new neighborhood electric vehicles, 3 from E-Ride, which is a firm that pretty much supplies industrial needs. But we also have a Zen electric vehicle from greencar.com. Is Tim here? Please, stand up, please. From Janesville, they have a Zen electric car. And then we have privately owned vehicles. This is very important. Privately owned vehicles with owners that are provided either data or they will stand by their cars and tell you what their mileage is. They will give you real performance data on these automobiles. Particularly in Wisconsin, I learned myself as being a new Ford Escape hybrid owner that the mileage that you get during the summertime in a hybrid is not as good as what you get, it's much better than what you get during the wintertime. Well, that's the show that's coming up afterward, and I invite all of you to come sometime during this 11 to 2:15 period. But my purpose, of course, is to introduce our speaker who is coming from Plug-in America in California. This is Mr. Mark Geller. He's a graduate of Grinnell College in history. He then spent 15 years in freelance photography before becoming involved in the automobile movement in the late 1990s, early 2000s. He'll be talking extensively about that. He is the founder, or co-founder, I'm sorry to say, of a website called don'tcrush.com. This was an effort by owners of electric vehicles in California to keep GM and Ford and Toyota from crushing the electric vehicles that those companies had produced from 1997 through about 2001. That website and the group that was formed morphed into what is now Plug in America. Same group, much more active. They have been a pressure group on the Obama administration. They have made significant contributions to renewable energy legislation. And I really, really am very happy to introduce Mark Geller, who will talk about his experience with electric cars. Thank you very much.
Morning. Thank you very much for inviting me here to Whitewater today. Thank you, Professor Ripsky and Professor Compass. Let me just first ask, does anybody in the audience have a car? Quite a few. Okay. Would anybody in the audience be interested in a car that doesn't use gasoline and doesn't cause emissions while you're using it? Okay. Well, it's hopeful then. You might be interested in what I have to say. But really, that I'm here speaking, is the sound okay? Because it sounds like it may be too loud to me. Okay. It's a little odd, really, that I'm speaking to you as an authority on electric cars, because I'm not an industry guy, I'm not an academic, I'm not a professional environmentalist. I'm just really a guy who kind of accidentally ended up with an electric car, and had his life kind of turned around by the experience, and I've ended up being, you know, one of a very few, you know, sort of major advocates for electric cars. So there are unfortunately very few people like me around. Since the early 1900s, when electrics actually briefly outnumbered gasoline cars, only a few thousand consumers have had the opportunity to own, or to possess, really, more accurately speaking, an electric car made by a real automaker. Those of us who did have that chance, people who drove the GM EV1, have people heard of the EV1? Do you know what I'm talking about? The EV1 was an all-electric car made by General Motors in the 90s. So those of us who had the opportunity to drive that car or drive Toyota RAV4 EVs, another all-electric car, we've kind of come to feel like the possessors of secret knowledge. The secret knowledge is simply that electric cars work, despite what the government or the automakers or even environmental organizations or certainly oil companies might have you believe. The cars work. So we, the holders of this secret knowledge, first, basically we created a consumer movement to prevent, as Professor Ripsky mentioned, the destruction of the electric cars that were produced in the 90s. What you may not know or even ultimately find hard to believe is that the car makers produced electric cars and then turned around and actually destroyed them. So cars that were running without gas were taken from consumers and destroyed. And basically my story, I'm going to go on about this quite a bit here. So just to clarify, when I talk about an electric car, I'm talking about a car that plugs into the wall, recharges its battery, and drives without using gasoline. Now, there are other things that are being spoken of. Someone asked the question of Sonia about plug-ins. They were referring to plug-in hybrids, taking a hybrid car, which today can't plug in. You have to understand, a hybrid car is a very sophisticated and fairly wonderful car in most cases, but it's a gasoline car. Without gasoline, a hybrid car does not go. And for that reason, I won't really put up with anyone talking about the Prius, for example, as an alternative fuel vehicle. There is, Toyota might, in fact, Toyota often does, but there's nothing really alternatively fueled about the Prius. So what we end up with is regular cars that use gas, hybrids that use gas, the idea of plug-in hybrids, where you will be able to plug in the car for some of the power, some of the energy, and then use the gasoline engine for the rest of it. Which one did I mention here? Plug-in hybrids, all gas cars, all electric cars. So you understand, when I refer to plug-in cars, I'm referring to any car that can get some of its energy from the grid, from the electric grid. So that could be a plug-in hybrid, and that could be an all-electric car. So I'm going to tell you my electric car story, and hopefully through it make the case for plug-in cars. So since August 2001, my only car has been electric. And driving that car for that period of time, those cars for that period of time, I've come to believe that electric cars are really not only necessary, but actually inevitable. And that the sooner we begin the process of electrifying personal transportation and begin the process of getting off oil, and that would include, in terms of electrifying transportation, cars, scooters, motorcycles, trains. There was a reference to high-speed high-speed rail. You know, it ought to be electric. The sooner we do all of that, the better off we'll be. And the sooner we also understand the history, which I don't get into too much, of electric transportation in the United States and what happened to it, the better off we'll be. I'm sure that Madison at one point, though I don't know specifically, probably had electric trams or electric buses that provided zero petroleum, zero emission transportation throughout the area. And this is something that we're going to have to look towards for the future. So so anyway, my experience, but electric cars, in my experience, not only are going to be better for you, but they're actually, and better for the country, and better for the nation, and better for the world, but they're also actually a better experience. The odd thing with electric cars is they're actually better cars. And so if you're just kind of a car lover, you'll be surprised to find that you would probably prefer to find yourself in an electric car. And I'm going to cover a wide range of stuff. At the end, you'll have plenty of opportunity to ask questions and challenge me on some of this stuff. But so I come to this, like most Americans, with a complicated sort of odd love affair with cars. As a child, I always recognized various makes and models of cars. For a long time, I thought I wanted an MG because that was my initials. Very sophisticated analysis of automobiles there. As an adult, I used a car for work and vacation and considered gasoline for cars the natural order of things. I really never thought about it much. But as even President Bush ultimately said of the nation, and it certainly applied to me, we had become addicted to oil. And there have been big consequences. You don't need me to tell you the consequences of our oil addiction. There's environmental consequences, health consequences, economic consequences, also domestic and international political consequences. So we really do need to get off oil. And if we're going to do that, as one of Sonia's slides showed in terms of greenhouse gases, it's about transportation. Oil is about transportation. Everything else we pretty much power with electricity. And electricity is generated from a wide variety of sources. We make decisions about how we want to generate electricity. But it's also got certain redundancies built in because unlike oil, which you have to go and dig out, you can decide. We're going to use solar power. We're going to use wind. We're going to use coal. We're going to use nuclear. There are many, many options. And if you look at what supplies the energy for Wisconsin, for example, it's not simply coal, though coal is the overwhelming, perhaps 70% of the electricity generated in Wisconsin is probably coal, and that ought to go down over time, and I suspect it will. But electricity has this tremendous advantage of being able to be sourced in many different ways. And as I said, a trend towards more renewable, cleaner electricity that's being asserted in every state and through the nation in various mechanisms. So the energy next year will be cleaner than the energy this year, off into the future, quite inevitably. So what happened to me was I didn't realize it, but in August 2001, when I ended up with my electric car, I had kicked the habit. Suddenly I was not using oil. So it was thanks to the at one time very enlightened policies of the state of California that 8 years ago I began driving an electric car. But it's really not like I intended to be Mr. Greener than thou. As a kid, does anyone here know what a Citroën is? A couple of the older members of the audience. Citroën is a French car. You can't get it here in America anymore, though they do still make them. It was sold in the United States when I was a kid, and it was really an elegant, weird, and incredibly comfortable vehicle that didn't look like any American car. And I really thought they were cool, but I couldn't convince my parents to get one. So as an adult, I was able to make my own mistakes and got Citroën station wagons, my particular automobile addiction, and had them for about 15 years. I really loved them, but I'll tell you, they emitted all kinds of stuff. They tended to leak. But when I looked, and I thought, ugh, this car is leaking. But when I looked at the street, I realized, well, cars leak. I mean, streets are you know, a virtual Jackson Pollock painting of splotches. And it wasn't just from Citroens, I can assure you. You know, there just weren't enough of them around. My car gave off all kinds of noxious odors. But I looked around, and every car had a tailpipe. Every car was polluting, giving off, you know, crap at one level or another. And my car may have been polluting a bit more, and I may have a little bit more to pay back over time. But it was just like every other car. It polluted a bit, but my car was my car, and my car was awesome. Loved my car. So I developed this attachment, this slightly sick attachment to my car. But around the year 2000, my last Citroen station wagon was clearly dying, and it was making unreasonable financial demands upon me. I was really not willing to put it on life support. So I had to face the fact that my Citroen period was over. And I really did want another funky old car. How many people here just prefer funky old cars as opposed to something new? A lot of people. I mean, those cars were beautiful, and you know, there's just something to the old way they made those things. They may have been more unsafe, and they may have polluted more, but they were cool. So I wanted a funky old car, but because of the sort of death process of my Citroen revealing how dirty old cars are, I really couldn't do it. So in the background, we also had all the news about Iraq starting up again and the possibility of war there again. And the irony for me that, again, people would be driving cars to anti-war rallies with no Blood for Oil stickers on them. And I thought, there's got to be a better way. So I'd read about, I mean, I was in California, and certainly electric cars had been in the news during the 90s because there was this mandate in California to produce zero emission vehicles, vehicles, cars that would travel down the road without producing any emissions. And that was a great law. And I figured if I'd heard about electric cars and they existed, well, I'd get one. A little naive on my part. Little did I know, really, what I'd stepped into when I started to pursue information about electric cars. But in a nutshell, I kind of found out the following. First, the car companies could build good electric cars, some even great electric cars. I found out when I looked into it that electric cars pollute a whole lot less than gasoline cars when you take into account, as you really must, the full cycle of production of fuel for cars. And to me, that's just beyond question now. The idea that you're simply transferring the pollution from the vehicle to the power plant is really, it's a misnomer. Clearly, we obviously make electricity. That has some environmental impact, but the environmental impact is less per mile. I also found out that electricity costs a lot less per mile than gasoline. Now, electricity prices are very different all over the country and sometimes at different times of day. But I live in basically one of the most expensive markets for electricity. And electricity is cheaper than gasoline. And I also found out that government could compel the production of electric cars. So good government policy would mean, as far as I was concerned, the opportunity to have some choice, to not be restricted to simply buying a gasoline car. But most importantly, what I found out was that while not the government nor automakers or even environmental organizations were particularly boosters of electric cars, I found out that the actual consumers who had the opportunity to drive electric cars loved them. They were really quite ecstatic and often quite surprised. Because the electric cars were clean, quiet, fast, or in some cases just kind of fast enough, cheap to operate, and overall more convenient than the gas cars that they had driven all their lives. Waking up with a full battery, sufficient for the day's driving, was actually better than having to go once a week to a gas station. Well, the internet really changed everything in terms of access to information. And had the net not existed, I probably wouldn't be speaking here to you today, because I would have only read a few newspaper articles that said the government and the automakers say this electric car project will never get off the ground and the cars don't work. But because of the web, I was actually in touch with and reading the experiences of the actual folks who were driving these cars. And they shared information about places to charge, ultimately creating an online map of available charging facilities. And they exchanged views on whether the electric car programs would continue or were actually soon to be ended by the car makers, and what to do about it. They were a new virtual community before we sort of knew what we were creating on the web was virtual communities. These were the possessors of this secret knowledge, and I wanted in. I mean, it sounded really cool. Driving around without gasoline, finding places to plug in, free, to carry on. I mean, this was just, to me, awesome. So I was surprised to find out that every major automaker had made an electric car. Ford, GM, Nissan, Toyota, Chrysler, they were all obligated. But, you know, who really knew that? I mean, I kind of doubt most people here think that all these car companies had made an electric car, a car you plug in, and that the consumers who were driving them loved them. So what I found out was that every car maker made a car, and that none of them was available to be purchased. They had a lease agreement, no right to purchase the car. I thought, interesting, but I'd be willing to do it. So by the time I came along in 2000, the program had already been existing for 3 or 4 years. And actually, cars were not any longer available. I got placed on waiting lists everywhere. I was on a waiting list for the 140-mile range GM EV1. Okay, this is a car that goes 140 miles on a single charge. And when I say 140 miles, that means at freeway speed. So if you kind of crept along at 30 miles an hour, you probably get 175 or 200 miles out of it. So I got placed on this waiting list. I went for a test drive. But even the enthusiastic EV1 specialist who accompanied me on this ride by 2000 saw the writing on the wall and said flat out, I would never get a car. And so I was testing this car, driving along the streets, you know, at a modest speed. I'm really not a raceaholic or anything. And she said, floor it, you know, enjoy it, because you ain't gonna get a car, play now. And she loved the car. She couldn't get a car either. Okay, Honda also made a car, the car that I really thought I wanted, which was a two-door, about 110-mile range, 4 or 5 passenger vehicle, compact car, good for parking in San Francisco, where there is no parking. But they were only required to make 300 of them, and I was too late. You know, I went to the dealer anyway, thinking maybe if I'd gone to the dealer, I could kind of squeeze a car out of them. And they, of course, were interested in pushing the Honda Insight at that point, their early hybrid. Still the hybrid, I think, that has gotten the most fuel-efficient hybrid at around 60 or 70 miles per gallon. And even as we were driving around this little Insight in the dealership, I saw an EV Plus, this electric car in the back. And I said, that's what I want. That's the car. And he just looked at me and he said, forget it. They don't really work. You don't want that car. Which was, you know, just incredibly depressing, because there was the car. You know, who goes into an auto dealer and has the guy say, no, you can't have the car we've got here? Really shocked me. Later, that same guy told me about somebody who had returned his EV Plus after having it for 3 years, 2 or 3 years, and was crying because there was no successor vehicle. They'd learned to love their electric car and were really, as I ultimately at some point was, torn up about what do you do once you've kind of, you know, you've seen the light, and then they're keeping the product from you. So anyway, there were also these other cars that were made in quasi-significant numbers. The Ford Ranger EV pickup, so if you're a pickup truck guy, there were electric pickup trucks made. And the Toyota RAV4 EV, these were cars that the automakers restricted to fleets. As a consumer, they just weren't interested in dealing with you. If you were a city or a utility, you know, they could sell you a few dozen cars. They could lease you a few dozen cars. But I did manage to get test drives in these vehicles, because at this point I was really getting smitten with electric. I wanted to just drive every electric car I could possibly drive. And they all work fine. Some had 50 miles range, 75 miles range, 140 mile range. There were differences in the car, but they all worked. So dozens of calls and emails and letters and visits to dealers, but I was getting nowhere. I was not getting my electric car. And I knew that I was not alone. The numbers of cars that were required to be built by the mandate never equaled the number of consumers who expressed an interest in the vehicles, who wanted a car. And this, of course, is in a world where, you know, 99% of the people don't even know an electric car is possible, let alone actually having been put into production. So at this point, half I wanted an electric car was because I was convinced it was good for the environment and I wouldn't use petroleum. But half of me just wanted that damn electric car because they wouldn't give it to me. And so I don't want to dwell on the past and the betrayals by the automakers and the government, because I really do believe the future of plug-in cars is very, very bright. But a little history helps. Unbeknownst to me, as I said, just as I got interested in electric cars, a chapter was ending. In 1990, California had boldly mandated that by 2003, 10% of the cars sold in California must be zero-emission vehicles. By the time I began my pursuit in 2000, that requirement had been whittled down to a few thousand vehicles. And the cars were gone, accounted for, on the road, being driven by very satisfied customers. So my electric car story might have ended there, as most people's did, without a car. But then, oddly, early in 2001, an email arrived mentioning a new electric offering from Ford. And they had actually bought a Norwegian electric car company. Already struck me as a little odd, a Norwegian electric car company. Anyway, they rebranded it Think, and were about to bring 500 cars to New York and California. The Think City was a whole lot less car than I wanted. It was a plastic two-seater, about the size and look of a smart car, at the point that smart cars were considered to be just really too un-American to consider bringing to the American marketplace. It had a top speed of 58 miles an hour, and a maximum range, excuse me, of 52 miles. So it was really the least of the electrics that had been produced by automakers to meet the mandate. But I figured it was now or never. I had been late to the party. I hadn't been looking into electric cars in the 90s when the people who managed to get them were. And the pickings were slim to non-existent, so I'd better do it. I placed an order, sight unseen. The lease was $199 a month. I figured, what did I have to lose? And I also thought, maybe this freeway legal, but really very small car, and much smaller than my wonderful Citroën station wagon, would kind of disabuse me of the notion, the growing belief, that the reintroduction of electric cars should be one of the major projects of the 21st century. Well, I got my electric car in August 2001 during California's electricity crisis that you may have heard of, when Enron did all sorts of market manipulations and basically celebrated the fact that they were screwing old people in California, which you can hear about on in a wonderful movie called the Smartest Guys in the Room. I mean, they were out for not blood, they were just out for money, as that usually is what. Anyway, so California's electricity crisis was going on. Gas was really still cheap, and I actually looked like the last idiot to get an electric car. But then, a month later, came September 11th, 2001, and the connection between our thirst for oil and the funding of terror networks became really more apparent than ever. And at the same time, there was this growing concern about global warming. You know, 40 to 50% of greenhouse gases in most places come from petroleum being burnt for transportation. So here I was, a guy who didn't want to drive a gasoline car to a anti-war rally for logical reasons. But suddenly I was driving an electric car that met the needs of people whose politics was very different from mine. I suddenly could have conversations with somebody whose tremendous concern was about national security or all of the conversations that were engendered by 9/11. And suddenly, I was really on the right side. I wasn't spending my money on gasoline, which went back to fund terror networks. So here I was, driving around without gasoline, paying more than ever for electricity, perhaps, but still spending less to fuel the car than I had previously a gas car. So I was thinking, this works. I mean, this is exactly what people want. A car that doesn't use gas, doesn't cause emissions, doesn't fund terror networks. I mean, you can really go on and on the checklist of benefits from electric cars. And, most importantly, the car was completely reliable. It was surprisingly peppy off the line. The lack of any vibration in an electric car is really very relaxing. Regenerating electricity while braking and going down hills was exhilarating and a revelation, about efficiency. And just to explain, regenerative braking is what's possible in a modern electric car when you basically, instead of drawing energy from the batteries to propel the car, when you engage it by putting on the brake or going down a hill, it kind of spins the motor back in the other direction and puts electricity created from the momentum of the car back into the battery. So I literally, when I'm going down a reasonable sized hill, I watch my fuel gauge go up, which is just never going to happen in a gas car. But I literally go down hills and watch my state of charge of my battery increase, which I got to tell you is awesome. So I was loving my car, but there was also no end of interest in my car. I was stopped multiple times a day by people wondering whether the car was electric because it looked like it should be, you know, small little plastic box. And people asking how well it worked and many of them asking where they could get one. One guy actually, you know, sort of drove on the side of me and kind of nudged me off the road until I was willing to stop. There was a cop in San Francisco who pulled me over with his siren blaring only to find out about the car. So it was clear to me a diverse group of people, not just some, you know, predictable segment of the population, was interested. I drove that car about 25,000 miles over the next 3 years, and my appreciation of both the Think Electric car and my understanding of what electric cars offer us as individuals, as Americans, and simply as people, grew. The simple convenience of waking up to a full battery at less than half the cost of gasoline, driving around in a car without a tailpipe, I just simply didn't contribute to all the pollutants coming out of the exhaust pipes around me. And let's face it, you know, you stand on a road with cars going by and it stinks. We really don't think about it. It's kind of the wallpaper of our lives, but it stinks. An electric car on the grid in California, it's incontestable that an electric car is much cleaner. But even in a state where most of the electricity comes from coal, there are environmental benefits and no real environmental costs to electric cars, to plugging in instead of filling up at the tank. And what happened to many EV drivers, including electric vehicle drivers, including myself, was they started to put solar panels on their house, because they were realizing the fuel here is electricity. I can make electricity. I mean, I've heard about this solar power thing. I can make electricity, which means I can make my own fuel for my car. So it becomes a very compelling idea that you can do this. And in fact, what you realize eventually is you can make the energy for your house and the energy for your car. And for me, what was important on some level, besides the environmental benefit, was I got to cut out the oil companies and essentially cut out the electric utility, who, though I'm very happy now that the electric utilities supply electricity for vehicles, potentially, I don't like the electric utility any more than probably anyone else here does. We've got Pacific Gas and Electric. I hated them for 20 years. You've got Wisconsin, whatever it is. Anyone here love the local electric utility? Got a lot of friends? One guy. Probably works for him. God bless him. They're great. They're going to supply us the fuel of the future, but no love lost. So I thought, a real twofer, knock out oil companies and electric utilities in one go, really pretty great. But surely we all know a few solar panels on roofs really can't power millions of plug-in cars. And people rightly wonder whether the electric grid can handle the introduction of plug-in cars. Short answer, yes, it can. Surprising source of information. The Department of Energy, under President Bush, the immediate previous president, did a study, and they reported that because most charging will occur when people sleep, inevitably, the grid today could handle it if even 3/4 of our cars were plug-in cars. We've got enough electricity available to us, the capacity to make electricity with existing infrastructure, the existing plants today, to power way more cars, way more plug-in cars than could possibly be produced in the next decade. So it is just not something to really worry about. There's a utility representative I often find myself speaking with who, in order to make it clear what the amount of electricity we're talking about here for plug-in vehicles, 3 plasma screen TVs equal a plug-in hybrid. And, you know, plasma screen TVs, you know, I think have taken off. Lots of families probably have 2 or 3 of them. The utilities didn't do any special preparing. When suddenly there was this new device that used a lot more electricity, they adapted, they adjusted, they did it. And the same thing can happen today with cars. So the drivers of these electric cars in California simply wanted the electric vehicle mandate to continue in order that, and to slightly expand so that more people could have this experience. And our hope was that as more people had the experience of driving electric cars, they would be, you know, somewhat transformed, as I was, in their belief of what a vehicle ought to be. But in reality, the political fix was in. Despite passionate testimony by many drivers on the successes of the electric car mandate, in 2003, California again revised the regulations, going along with the automakers' desire to make very few, impossibly expensive, and technologically complex hydrogen fuel cell vehicles. People here know about hydrogen fuel cell vehicles. I'm not going to go on about it too much, but if you haven't heard about it, all the better. It's just a diversion, but happy to talk about it if anyone has any questions. So thousands of actual electric cars in the hands of real consumers, on the other hand, were gradually removed from the roads when their leases ended. They would not extend the lease. The automakers simply had revised the regulations and had no interest in the cars remaining on the road, even if the drivers wanted them. So drivers explored legal options, but really no recourse existed. The drivers of electric cars tended to be people who owned their own home, not that unusual, and they really couldn't consider a fight against Ford or General Motors, where ultimately, if they refused to give back their car, their house might be put on the line. So they had the automobile makers had a fairly compliant group of people, they thought. So we then took to the streets, and we began protests. You know, I mean, when you have no other option, you basically stand in the street and you make your point of view known. And so we had protests first in San Francisco, when Ford canceled the Think program, and eventually in Sacramento and Los Angeles. And despite denials at the time from the automakers, evidence was accumulating that the electric cars were actually being crushed, being destroyed. And you can see more about that in the really great film, Who Killed the Electric Car? Highly recommend it. And you can actually, you know, they basically took these cars out to the desert and shot them in the back of the head long before they ought to have been discarded. So as Professor Ribsky said, don'tcrush.com, a group made up of drivers of electric cars, possessors of this secret knowledge, who couldn't believe that this was happening after 9/11, after we'd come to understand global warming, we came together, and to cut to the chase, Ford and Toyota decided they didn't want us protesting anymore, and they made agreements with us to stop destroying the cars and to let some of the drivers continue to lease them. And so the cars that we saved, along with the few hundred cars that had almost accidentally been sold by the car companies to private consumers, number today a couple of thousand, that they continue to function beyond our and the automakers' really wildest dreams, is pretty much all the motivation that we need to continue fighting for electric cars. I mean, it's very hard to continue to hear about how electric cars won't work for one reason or another when you're driving one every day and it just continues to function fine. So in 2004, Ford confiscated, recalled, whatever language you want to use, my Think City at the end of its lease. And I knew I really personally couldn't go back to gasoline. And even though there were hybrids out at the time, I must say I had concluded that that included hybrids. That is, as you know, they were more efficient, but they were gasoline cars, and I really did not want a car that I had to put gasoline in. So I had to explore various alternatives, and we can talk about this a little bit more if people want to, because there are lots of alternatives always thrown out there as alternative ways to get off of gasoline, including ethanol, CNG, compressed natural gas, and biodiesel. But I must say, all seemed quite the compromise when compared with electric and what my experience was with driving the Think City. I must say that in California, ethanol is really an automaker scam more than anything else. There are lots of reasons ethanol isn't a great fit for California, but for me, it made really clear how nefarious the automakers could be. Because here they were with hundreds of thousands of flex fuel vehicles that could use ethanol on the roads in California that they were selling as environmental vehicles, and for which they were attaining various credits on the environmental checklist required by the federal government and the state government. But there was in California, up until very, very recently, a grand total of one ethanol station. So they were getting credits for selling a car where the fuel didn't exist. So all those cars were gasoline cars. So that didn't make any sense to me. And CNG is cleaner burning than gasoline and probably should have been an alternative available 20 years ago in order to make it so we didn't have a monopoly of petroleum. But alas, there are very few CNG cars. The biodiesel people were really great. I often meet with biodiesel people at alternative fuel events, but the reality is they kind of were jealous of my car. And those, you know, old Mercedes Benzes that had been converted or were running biodiesel all looked a bit like my Citroën and a little bit too dirty. I didn't really want to go there. So I was lucky enough to be able to actually buy a used Toyota RAV4 EV. And with that RAV4 EV, I've doubled the range of my Think City. I easily get over 100 miles per charge. With public charging stations that exist in California, I easily drive 90 miles to Sacramento, to the capital of the state, plug my car in, testify for electric cars at the various agencies, return to a full battery for the drive back to San Francisco, after listening to bureaucrats tell me it was not possible. With RV parks and my friends' dryer outlets, I've driven really all over Northern California, whether or not there's infrastructure available. I just plug my car in at their house. And it confirms to me that, you know, every day, that building a practical, useful, economic electric car has been within reach for more than a decade. And that really makes me more than a little angry. Today we have near bankrupt car companies peddling product people don't want to buy, due in some part to years of hostility to government regulation, now begging that same government for bailouts. Oil continues to drain our economy and our pocketbooks, and it's only going to get worse. We really won't have $2 gas forever. I know I'm running out of time here. I want to just sort of cut to the chase. So we could have had electric cars made today. The government has always been reluctant to prod companies to do what the government thinks is best. The federal government sued California the federal government sided with the automakers who were suing California to eliminate the electric car program. So it seems to me now we've got a government where they are interested in plug-in cars. President Obama's mission, his goal of 1 million plug-in cars by 2015 is a good one, but clearly there's going to be a lot of fight in order to get plug-in cars on the agenda in a big way in these coming months and years. And one of the things that we're going to have to do is continue to keep on the pressure. And this is my little shameless plug for Plug-in America. When the stimulus package was up, we activated the membership of Plug-in America and got 60,000 letters to the Congress and to Obama supporting various plug-in initiatives that were not in the original legislation, and ultimately got about $14 billion worth of support for plug-in cars, including a $7,500 tax credit that will apply to electric and plug-in cars that you can buy within the next couple of years. Let's move along. I mean, basically, my point here is that everyone has a reason to support plug-in cars and getting them to the market and support the policies that will promote that choice for various reasons, whether you're an environmentalist, whether you're concerned about global warming, if you're concerned about peak oil, if you're concerned about our economic security, our national security. Electric cars will do a lot for you. So basically, let me just conclude by saying, if what you really want to do is drive your gasoline car, your favorite gasoline car, until either it or you, you know, breathe your last gasp, you'd better hope that an awful lot of us switch to electricity. Because if we don't, the price of gasoline is going to be just out of this world as Indians and Chinese and the entire world gets turned on to kind of the glory of personal cars. Thank you. Oh, sorry about that. I was really droning on. Yeah, either way, go ahead, start up. And if you shout, I can hear you. Well, absolutely, I think they have a role to play. One of the things I cut out here because of time was the role of these smaller companies. I think that Tesla certainly has proven that you can get a car company off the ground. I think we have a rare opportunity now because of the desperation of the big car companies to get the government somewhat more focused on the benefit of plug-in vehicles and move to get the government to make that a condition of the bailouts, as well as much more liberally offer support for new companies, like Tesla, like Fisker, and like a few oddballs, like Aptera, which has a three-wheeled all-electric vehicle. So I'm definitely hopeful.
Well, I was wondering if we can turn, if we have a solar panel for houses and we can turn it into electric energy, do you think we could put like a grid on our windshields or on top of the car and turn that into electric energy?
I think what you were asking was whether we can put solar panels or integrate solar in a car in order to generate electricity to help the car run. And of course we can, and there are people who've done that. There have even been all solar cars or close to all solar cars. The problem is the amount of space available on a car and the amount of energy you can create with the solar panel is probably not terribly cost effective. If you put a solar panel on the roof of a car and left it in the sun all day, you might add 5 miles to the car. So it certainly would be a way that you would probably never run out of juice, but whether you'd want to pay the additional $1,000 or $2,000 for that perceived benefit is up in the air. But I'll tell you that Toyota is talking very seriously about putting solar panels on the roof of next generation Priuses or as an option, because it sounds super cool. And you know, they're going to be promoting the hell out of solar panels on the roof of their car instead of doing what they probably ought to do and know could be done, which is making plug-in hybrids in all electric cars. Well, assuming that what you want is an affordable electric car, did everyone hear the question? He wanted to know where you could buy one today. Today you can buy low-speed electric vehicles that go only about 25 miles an hour. You can buy a Tesla, which costs $109,000, and you'd have to wait a year. You can put yourself on the waiting list for something like the Aptera, which is a three-wheeled very futuristic, almost Jetsons-like vehicle, and that should cost between $25,000 and $40,000. Or you could do what is the most affordable option, really, and you'd end up learning a lot, which is build your own or buy a car that somebody has converted. And for between, you know, $3,000 and $15,000 or $20,000, depending on the batteries and componentry, et cetera, you can get yourself a pretty awesome little electric car, and we'll be able to look at this gentleman's car outside that, you know, might go freeway speeds and maybe goes 40 or 50 miles in range, which sounds terrible when you first think about it, until you calculate what you do every day. And you'll find you don't drive much more than that most of the time. And if you need to go further, you know, you can borrow a friend's car. Or use car share.
Mark, thanks a lot. I'm really jealous. You're like driving the future, and I want to get there. Somewhere the future took a wrong turn, and I'm sure GM is regretting that now. I've got a few announcements here before we break. We're now splitting up into the separate breakout sessions, which start in about 5 minutes at 11. So there's a chance for a quick break, and I want to kind of go over the schedule again on the breakout sessions. We have three of them that are upstairs. You go around the corner to get to the stairs, and those are a discussion of what's happening on UW-Whitewater campus in regards to sustainability. We've got another session looking at the role of religion and greening religion that's also upstairs, and a discussion about local foods and how you can get your produce that comes from a local farmer instead of someplace in California. And back in this room at 11 o'clock, we're going to hear from Tamara Dean about actually human power itself as an alternative source of fuel. So please take a short break and join us at the breakout sessions at 11. And then after that, we've got lunch. All right. Oh, and don't forget the car show that's at the north end of Upham Hall. Thank you.